Prayer. So we'll be using the Book of Common Prayer this morning. Welcome to those who are online and for those who are gathered. It's so nice to be here, to be able to see people, to be in the same room, to have prayers together. It's just warms my heart to be able to do that. So I invite you to join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Please join me in the cult for the day and this prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts be open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, whose kingdom is everlasting and power infinite, have mercy upon the whole church, and so rule the heart of thy chosen servant Elizabeth, our queen and governor, that she, knowing whose minister she is, may above all things seek thy honor and glory, and that we and all her subjects, duly considering whose authority she has, may faithfully serve, honor, and humbly obey her, in thee and for thee, according to thy blessed word and ordinance, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with thee and the Holy Ghost liveth and reigneth ever one God, world without end. Amen. And please join me for the collect of the day as printed in your bulletin. Let us pray. O God, whose never-failing providence ordereth all things, both in heaven and earth, we humbly beseech thee to put away from us all hurtful things, and to give us those things which be profitable for us, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Reading is from the 2 Samuel chapter 11, verses 1 to 15. In the spring of the year, the time when kings go out to battle, David sent Joab with his officers and all Israel with him. They had ravaged the Ammonites and deceived Rabbah. But David remained at Jerusalem. It happened late one afternoon when David rose from his house and was walking about on the roof of the king's house that he saw from the roof a woman bathing. The woman was very beautiful. David sent someone to inquire about the woman. It was reported, "This is Bathsheba, daughter of Liam, and wife of Uriah the Hittite." So David sent messengers to get her, and she came to him, and he lay with her. Now she was purifying herself from her period. Then she returned to her house. The woman conceived, and she sent and told David, "I'm pregnant." So David sent word to Joab, "Send me Uriah the Hittite." And Joab sent Uriah to David. When Uriah came to David, David asked how Joab and the people fared and how the war was going. Then David said to Uriah, "Go down to your house and wash your feet." Uriah went out of the king's house, and there followed him a present from the king. But Uriah slept at the entrance of the king's house with all the servants of his lord, and did not go down to his house. When they told David Uriah did not go down to his house, David said to Uriah, "You have just come from the journey. Why did you not go down to your house?" Uriah said to David, "The ark of Israel and Judah remain in booths, and my lord Joab and the servants of my lord are camping in the open field. Shall I then go to my house to eat and drink and to lie with my wife? As you live and your soul lives, I will not do such a thing." Then David said to Uriah, "Remain here today also, and tomorrow I will send you back." So Uriah remained in Jerusalem that day. On the next day, David invited him to eat and drink in his presence and made him drunk. In the evening, he went out to lie on his couch with the servants of his lord, but he did not go down to his house. In the morning, David wrote a letter to Joab and sent it by the hand of Uriah. In the letter, he wrote, "Set Uriah in the forefront of the hardest fighting, and then draw back from him so that he may be struck down and die." Here ends the first reading. The second reading is from Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 to 21. "For this reason I bow my knee before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth takes its name. I pray that, according to the riches of his glory, he may grant that you may be strengthened in your inner being with power through his Spirit, and that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, as you are being rooted and grounded in love. I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than we all can ask or imagine. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus, to all generations, forever and ever. Amen. We are at the second prayer.
The Holy Gospel is written in the sixth chapter of the Gospel according to St. John, beginning at the first verse. Glory be to thee, O Lord. After this, Jesus went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, also called the Sea of Tiberias. A large crowd kept following him because they saw the signs that he was doing for the sick. Jesus went up the mountain and sat down there with his disciples. Now the Passover, the festival of the Jews, was near. When he looked up and saw a large crowd coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread for these people to eat?" He said this to test him, for he himself knew what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 6 months' wages will not buy enough bread for each of them to get a little. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what are they among so many people?" Jesus said, "Make the people sit down." Now there was a great deal of grass in the place, so they sat down, about 5,000 in all. Then Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated, so also the fish, as much as they wanted. When they were satisfied, he told his disciples, "Gather up the fragments left over, so that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up, and from the fragments of the 5 barley loaves, left by those who had eaten, they filled 12 baskets. When the people saw the signs that he had done, they began to say, "This is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world." When Jesus realized that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, he withdrew again to the mountain by himself. When evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into a boat, and started across the sea to Capernaum. It was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. The sea became rough because a strong wind was blowing. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near to the boat. And they were terrified, but he said to them, "It is I, do not be afraid." Then they wanted to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat reached the land toward which they were going. Praise be to thee, O Christ. Lord Jesus, soften our hearts, our minds, our mouths, our ears, our very souls, that we may know you and draw closer to you. Amen. As I was reading and praying over the scriptures this week, I had to chuckle. See, for me, Bible stands for basic information before leaving home, before leaving earth. Basic information before leaving earth. So, as I keep that in the back of my mind, I'm reading about David. Now, David is one of our saints. David is one of our epic people. But I was able to giggle because the Bible has everything about life in it. David wasn't perfect. This is the story of David taking a boat, taking a shine, and doing something he absolutely knew he shouldn't have ought to have done. And yet, he still was a faithful man. Anybody else admit to having done something they had not ought to have done in their life at one time or another? May not be as big as getting a married woman pregnant and killing her husband. But I bet most of us kind of can reflect on a time where we did something that was against our morals, against our values, against our faithfulness in Christ. And the beauty of the Bible is it says we're supposed to be broken. We're supposed to be imperfect. We're supposed to be people that can learn from our mistakes. And boy, right now we need to remember that. There's no nation on the face of the earth that hasn't made, that's been around for any time, that hasn't made huge mistakes. Nations are basically groups of people making a decision, and our nation made a mistake. We need to stand up and say, yeah, we're not going to do that one again. Anybody else agree we're not going to do that one again? Not that my thought. I don't like repeating my mistakes. So, David allows us to take a look at ourselves and our faithfulness and our walk and not condemn ourselves. Not condemn ourselves. I don't know about you, but I was brought up kind of in a household that if you did wrong, you were supposed to feel guilty. It was supposed to be, you know, on your heart, the whole world came to an end. It just, I don't know, it was just kind of that way. But the Bible says, take a look at it, make a different decision, and keep going in knowledge and faith. Well, that doesn't say condemn yourself and never get over it. It says forgive yourself. Make a different decision. Repentance means make a different decision. That easy. It's not this big hunting word. It's a simple word. And how many of us have kind of thought in our mind, well, I could do that, and then made a different decision? That's the heart of Christianity. Not that we're never supposed to read that, we have bad thoughts. The Bible's full of people that had bad thoughts and acted on them. It's supposed to be that we manage them. We take a look, say, no, I choose to walk in faith. So when we look at the Ephesians letter, we look at the basis of how we are to live our life. And it's the ending of the BAS service. It comes from this Ephesians. And it basically invites us to do the most loving thing. Now back again how I was raised that you did the correct thing. But oftentimes I'll have a discussion with someone and I'll think, I'm coming from the correct place, and they're coming from the correct place, and we are not agreeing. Because we see things differently. And we're supposed to see things differently. Once again, the Bible is full of stories of two groups of people saying things differently and either having a good outcome or a not-so-good outcome. If I am right, then it's oftentimes a not-so-good outcome. But if I take a step back with curiosity and say, what's the most loving thing to do? Does it matter if I told my partner to turn right and he kept going because he wasn't listening to me and we ended up going around the block? Does it really matter? No. If we can laugh about it, it's so much better than if I look at him and say, you don't listen to me, and he looks at me and says, you distract me, and you know how it can begin, right? Oftentimes with those little things. What's the most loving thing we can do? So you take one side, a man who made some bad decisions, acted upon those bad decisions, but yet he did not throw him out with the bathwater. We still respect him for the good that he did. Allows us to make those decisions. Then how do we base our decisions? What is the most loving thing to do? Not only with others, but often with ourselves. We can make some of us, and me, but it can be often the hardest for myself, not necessarily on the people around me. And then when I ponder and reflected on the gospel reading, the first thing that hit me again was, Jesus got tired. I don't know about you guys, but over this last 18 months, there have been times when I have just been profoundly tired. Anybody else? Profoundly tired. And it sure helps me to realize that Jesus got profoundly tired. And what did he do? He acted upon that. He tried to take himself off to a quiet place, to have some time alone, to have some time with his disciples. And then he got up and he did his job. Yes, Jesus had a job from God. Part of that was to teach his disciples. So he gathered them together, taught the disciples, and kept going. They got tired again. And rejuvenated himself, went off and did a quiet time. And in the midst of the gospel story, I heard the invitation from Jesus that he gave to the disciples and to the young boy. Jesus knew how they were going to get fed. He already had the decision. He already had the means. He knew what was going to happen. But he invited us to participate. He invited the disciples. He said, what should we do? And they're looking at him like, remember all kids in school, and the teacher said, you're supposed to tell us what to do. No, Jesus invites us to use our brain, our common sense, and our heart. All three of them together. What are we doing? Well, here's a little boy that has, a token mound. Well, and I always thought growing up that meant that, there were literally six loaves of bread and six fish, and they fed, thousands. And I had a lovely woman, a woman of color, that said to me once in a pastor, no, I think that meant that we all had a picnic. Everybody took out what they had, their six loaves of fishes and their six pieces of bread or whatever, and shared it with each other. And I thought, yes. How oftentimes does Jesus invite us to be part of the solution? And how do we be part of the solution? By doing the most loving thing. Not through judgment, not through condemnation, but what is the most loving thing to do? I'll bet you we all have a little bit of extra canned food in our cupboards at home. We could share that with the homeless. We could share that with the people in need. I bet we could all have the ability to reach out and touch our neighbors. We all have the ability to pray and keep good thoughts about people. All those we're being invited to do. So at the end of the gospel reading, and at a time when we looked at all of these readings, the end comment was Jesus said, be not afraid. I have to admit, over this last year and a half, there were too many times when I said I can serve, but in reality, I was afraid. I was afraid for my grown-up children. I was afraid for people in the congregation. I was afraid of what was going on. So I prayed, but I still was afraid. Jesus says, be not afraid. I am with you. So as we go on now, it is our job to mature in the remembering that God has been here with us through all the pandemic. God doesn't say I'm going to make everything right and no one's ever going to have a hurt again. We just read it now. David worked with God, but David did some unspeakable things. Unspeakable things happen. A pandemic is an unspeakable thing. But God has been with us through it. And God says to us, be not afraid, for we will walk out of this. May not be this week. May take us a little bit more time, I believe it will. Be not afraid. Go out and do the most loving thing possible. Cut yourself and everybody else a break and live as faithful people. This is a wonderful, faithful community. And God is saying to us, be not afraid, walk in faith. In Jesus' name, amen. believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of the Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, through whom all things were made, who for us and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was made incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father, and he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe one holy apostolic and a Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Give unto the Lord the honor, do unto his name, bring an offering, and come into his courts.
Thank you.
almighty and ever-living God, who by thy holy apostle hast taught us to make prayers and supplication, and to give thanks for all people. We humbly beseech thee, most mercifully, to accept our alms and oblations, and to receive these our prayers, which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and common Lord. And grant that all they that do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. We offer prayers this Sunday for the Deanery of Huron Perth, for Holy Trinity Church in Lucan with the Reverend Matthew Martin, St. Paul's Church in Palmerston with the Reverend Cheryl Christian, and Trinity Church in Blythe with the Reverend Joanne Todd. We thank God for the gifts toward flowers that are given in loving memory of husband Tom, stepson Greg, and my mother Betty, the gift of Judy Petit. And for the month of July, we pray for our own parish family, for Bruce, Judy, Lorenzo and Karen and family, for William and Pauline and family, for Cindy, Patricia, Bonnie, Jeff and Stephanie and their family, Wanda, Robert and Leanne, their family, Deborah and her family, for Lois, for Patricia, for Dick and Dale, for Mark and Leanne and their family, for all, for Al and Annette, for Doris, for Patricia, for George, for Cheryl, for Reverend CJ and her family, and for Reverend Kennedy. We thank you, Lord, and ask peace upon them. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops, priests, and deacons, and especially to thy servant Todd, our bishop, that they may both in their life and doctrine set forth thy true and living word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. Prosper, we pray thee, all those who proclaim the gospel of thy kingdom among the nations, and to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation, that with meek hearts and due reverence, they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we most humbly beseech thee with thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all them who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity, especially those for whom our prayers are desired. We remember before thee, O Lord, all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear. And we bless thy holy name for all who in life and death have glorified thee, beseeching thee to give us grace, that rejoicing in their fellowship, we may follow their good examples, and with them be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant this, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate, to whom, with thee and the Holy Ghost, be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. Ye that do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead the new life, following the commandments of God, and walking from henceforth in God's holy ways, draw near with faith, and take this sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to God Almighty, meekly kneeling upon your knees if you are able. maker of all things, judge of all people, we acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, which we, from time to time, most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty. We do earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of God's gracious mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what comfortable words our Savior Christ saith unto all that truly turn to him. Come unto me, all that labor and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. God so loved the world that God gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Hear also what St. Paul saith. This is a true saying, and worthy of all to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear also what St. John said, if anyone sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks, thanks unto our Lord God. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty Everlasting God, Creator and Preserver of all things. Because through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who in substance of our mortal flesh manifested forth his glory, that he might bring us out of the darkness into his own marvelous light. Therefore, with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Glory be to thee, O Lord Most High. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessing and glory and thanksgiving be unto thee, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to take our nature upon him, and to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there, by his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute, and in his holy gospel command us to continue, a perpetual memorial of that his precious death, until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful God. We most humbly beseech thee, and grant that we, receiving these, thy creatures of bread and wine, according to thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread, and when he had given thanks, We thank you, God. He broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, we thank you, God. He gave it to them, saying, Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it, in remembrance of me. Wherefore, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, we, thy humble servants, with all thy holy church, remembering the precious death of thy beloved Son, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again in glory, do make before thee, in the sacrament of the holy bread of eternal life, and cup of everlasting salvation, the memorial which he hath commanded. And we entirely desire thy fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our own sins and all other benefits of his passion. And we pray that by the power of the Holy Spirit, all we who are partakers of this Holy Communion may be fulfilled with thy grace and heavenly benediction. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom, with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit.
And together, we do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table, but thou art the same Lord, whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we, moreover, may dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. O Lamb of God, that takest away the sin of the world, grant us thy peace.
Let us pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee that thou dost graciously feed us in these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, assuring us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are living members of his mystical body, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls, and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee. And although we are unworthy, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen. Glory be to God on high, and in earth peace, good will towards all. We praise thee, we bless thee, we worship thee, we glorify thee, we give thanks to thee for thy great glory. O Lord God, heavenly King, God the Father Almighty, O Lord, the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, O Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, that takest away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. Thou that takest away the sin of the world, receive our prayer. Thou that sittest at the right hand of God the Father, have mercy upon us. For thou only art holy, thou only art the Lord, thou only, O Christ, with the Holy Ghost, art most high in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds, and not in the knowledge and love of God, and of God's Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, be amongst you, your friends, and family, and remain there always. Amen. Please be seated for community news.
The trust funds from the diocese that were, can't hear me? Okay, and these sheets at the back are from the diocese. They were to be in our vestry report and they didn't make it in time. If you take one, please sign, or excuse me, put your initial beside your name in the lists that are there. The second announcement is there are envelopes back there. If any of them belong to you, please take them with you. Also, the garden chat will happen this week, Thursday from 10 to 12, but the next week is day camp. So unless you want to play games with the kids, we'll skip one week for the garden chat, okay? And then we'll get back to normal after that. And I believe those are all the announcements for now.
The beauty of the garden chat is some people who are not quite ready to come into the building feel comfortable coming to the garden chat. So if you're able to come, it's there the whole time. Some come at the beginning, some come at the end. Some stay all the time, but you're always welcome.
Into the world, rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Thanks be to God.